Welcome you in the sixth lecture of this series, MKB series lectures for relativistic quantum mechanics. Up to five lectures, we were concentrating on the KG equation, Klein-Gordon equation, that we have derived for free particle first, and then we applied the interactions and involved interactions actually given us some concepts of relativities and ideas behind the relativistic corrections. As outcome of this KG equation, we have realized firstly, that the negative energy comes. Because of negative energy, we can also have the negative probability. As a second aspect, we also studied that it works, relativity works as a perturbation so that the energy spectra gets splitted and shifted. And finally, we have seen that the KG equation is actually true or valid for the bosonic system. Going further to address the other class of particles involving half spin, one needs to derive Dirac equation. So, the very basic purpose of this lecture is first to derive Dirac equation, and for that again we will go in a similar way. First we write the mathematical operator correspondence, and that those operators we will write in the matrix form and matrix algebra, particularly the Clifold algebra that we will use to find the square root of matrix thing, and based on that we can derive the one first order differential equation for the relativistic free particle. So, in this lecture we derive the Dirac equation, and later on in this series as we proceed further, we get the inferences drawn out of this and we apply this Dirac equation to the further cases. So, I welcome you to this lecture, and I will try to derive the Dirac equation in the simplest manner we can possibly we can derive. So, welcome you.
So, welcome back, friends. In the last part, few parts rather, we have derived a relativistic KG equation. It was a second order differential equation with respect to space and time both. First, we derived a KG equation for a free particle, and then we incorporated the interaction among the two charged particles, Coulomb interaction, and then based on that we could derive the energy spectra of this charge assembly, and based on that we had given some important conclusions, like it is the many particle system. KG equation favors many particle system. It is the relativity who produce the perturbative effect, and the last but very important conclusion that we draw was that KG equation is basically successfully applicable to bosonic system. In between we come across one more limitation, or say the weakness of the KG equation, that it was not clearly able to describe the positive and negative probability. Though we multiplied the position probability and the current by the charge to give the interpretation, but that was the issue that we came across. People have realized very soon that probability which we have written in the KG equation P of RT as some prefactor I h cut by 2m0c square, correct, and then we have that psi star del psi by del t, and other way around, that is psi del psi star by del t. It is this time differentiation is the culprit. That's why probability can come as a positive and negative value. And this was the issue we have realized. This del by del t appears in the expression for the probability because it was a second order differential equation. So, KG equation, we know it is the second order differential equation with respect to space coordinate and time. So, Dirac has already realized that it is the issue with this second order. So, what he tried, that rather than deriving the relativistic equation as a second order differentiation, he tried to derive it in the first order. So, basically this Dirac equation which we are deriving for relativistic particle is the first order differential equation. It is first order. That was the intention in order to remove this discrepancy that how can the probability be negative. Apart from, we have also realized that relativistically when we compute the energy of even for a free particle, it comes out to be negative as well as positive. So this negative energy together with this issue with the probability density as a negative value. Now Dirac thought that why not we derive it in the first order with respect to time and space both. So this Dirac equation that we are deriving, and whatever procedure we have followed in the last topics, the same way we first derive it for the free particle. So we are firstly in this part, we are deriving the Dirac relativistic equation for a free particle. And therefore, let me start writing the expression for the total energy of the free particle, relativistic total energy. I am writing it as a E. Then we know that this can be written as C square P square plus M0 square C raised to 4 raised to half. And of course, we can write plus or minus. Okay? And it's not that just since we are writing the first order, so we can directly employ the operator correspondence for this IH. For E, we can write IH cut del by del T, and for P, we can write minus H cut square nabla square, because this is not the correct thing to do. Sorry. Reason is that we don't know the square root of any operator. So this is not the guarantee that you get the linear relation in operator. Operators are in quantum mechanics can also be written in the form of a matrix. We know that Heisenberg has suggested that we can write even Dirac has also postulated that we can write the operators in the matrix forms. So we cannot directly take a square root of this differential operator to get the linear relation among the energy operator and the momentum operator. But we know that if they are written in the matrix form, then square root of matrix is possible. And such a mathematics where we find the square root of the matrix was already proposed by the Clifford. So we are now basically writing everything in the Clifford notation, or we are employing the Clifford algebra, where square root of matrix is possible. So obviously, in order to get the first order operators, energy and the momentum, we are writing them in the matrix form, one. And secondly, we will be employing the Clifford algebra to get the linear relation. Once we get the linear relation, then it is obvious that that operator can operate on the state function psi, and we get the corresponding energy eigenvalues of a free particle moving relativistically high speed. Correct? So that's the purpose with which I start deriving the thing. And all the mathematics which we are writing is in the Clifford algebra. So let me write my energy expression again, but now this time I write as a square of it. So this term, or maybe let me write E itself, then this term C square P square plus M0 square C raised to 4 raised to half. This term we can write slightly differently. I can take C square common rather. So when it comes out of it, it will be only C only. So plus or minus C, it will be P square plus M0 square C square raised to half. The brilliant idea of Dirac is that this particular term, he tried to write as a whole square of certain thing. So what he proposed, that this term P square plus M0 square C square can also be written as a whole square of something. So what he proposed is that this term can be written as alpha px plus alpha py plus alpha z pz plus beta m0c whole square. And don't forget, p square means it is like a px square plus py square plus pz square. Correct? So basically, this we can write fully as a px square plus py square plus pz square plus m0 square c square. On the right hand side, we have basically whole square of this. So if I write fully, it is alpha x px plus alpha y py plus alpha z pz plus beta m0 c. Okay? And then it multiplies by itself. Where alpha x, alpha y, alpha z, beta, right now they are unknown. In fact, we are looking for a presentation, representation of this alpha x, alpha y, alpha z, beta. So what Dirac has thought, this term can be written as the whole square of this. And then we look for what are the representation of this alphas and beta. Okay? That is the thing which we can write. And if I expand this right hand side fully, then at least I will write few of them so that we can realize this alpha x and the same first term here. So it will make alpha x square px square. Right? Then I write the second term. This now goes with the second part, second term of the right bracket. So it will be alpha x px. Then second term here will be alpha y py. And so on and so forth. And then the first term multiplies to 4, so first 4 terms I can write. Then I go to the next line. Now this second term will multiply the first of it, so it will be alpha y px alpha x px. Then it multiplies to the second term, which is same term, so it will be alpha square py square, and similarly other two terms. And finally, if I write the last term, this beta term when multiplies to the first of them, so it will be beta m0c, first term will be your alpha x px, and then the last term will be beta square m0 square c square. Right? Here we should be a little careful, because we know that this px, py, pz are basically the operators. So please don't be in hurry to interchange their positions, that you can write px and py at the same time by interchanging. It's not possible, because they are the operators. And we know that in quantum mechanics, these operators obey the commutator rule. So we have to follow that commutation rule for each of them. Okay? Whereas the left hand side is as it is. So left side is your px square, py square, pz square. So no need to say, in order to have both sides equal, if we compare the term wise both sides, then px square with no prefactor, meaning their alpha x square must be unity. Similarly, there is no alpha y square term on the left side, so alpha y square will be 1. And likewise, what we conclude, that your alpha x square, alpha y square, alpha z square, and even beta square are all having value 1. Right? And therefore, if I write the eigenvalues of this alpha x and alpha y, if I write commonly alpha I, where I will go as x, y, z, then they have, and of course even beta, they have an eigenvalue which is plus or minus 1. Because alpha square is 1, so their eigenvalues are plus or minus 1. Right? Now we go to this part where there is a cross terms. So I write this term alpha x px alpha y py, and there is a similar term where the things are interchanged. So this part, which I write as a 2 underline, that alpha y px alpha x px, here it will be y. In fact, this alpha y py alpha x px, this term I try to consider. And there I apply my commutation rule between the operators px and py. We know that in quantum mechanics, these operators obey this commutation rule, and we know that this px py is 0, meaning your px py is equals to py px. So here also, if we assume that alpha x and px and alpha y and py, so alphas and p's, they commute to each other. This is the one assumption I make, that alphas and p commutes. In fact, we can prove also later on, but right now we assume that this alphas and p commute to each other. In the same thing, we can write like this, this alpha x, and then I write alpha y ahead of it. So we have px py. First term, I write like this, and then second term, in the same way, I can write as alpha y, alpha x, and py, px. But we know that instead of py, px, you can also write px, py, so that I can write commonly. So what I have, alpha x, alpha y, plus alpha y, alpha x, and that px, py term, I can write common. Similarly, with other such mixed term for alphas and p's, and even you can do with this type of term where betas and alphas and px are appearing, then you can prove that this px py term has a coefficient alpha x alpha y plus alpha y alpha x. Okay? But you can see on the left hand side, as such there is no mixed term like cross product x and y or y and z and like that. So there is no px py term on this left hand side. What it demands, that in order to have this two sides equal, this coefficient alpha x alpha y plus alpha x alpha x should be zero. Then and then this px py term can be get rid of, and therefore we write this square term, square bracket, as zero. So comparing left and right side, it demands this alpha x alpha y to be zero. Okay. So this is the one conclusion that we draw out of that. This alpha x and alpha y are giving you alpha x alpha y is basically minus alpha x, alpha y alpha x. Not only with this alpha x and alpha y, for other components of alphas and even for the beta and alpha, we have the same thing. So I write generally that your alpha I alpha j is equals to minus alpha j alpha I. No need to say your I and j goes as x, y, z. Correct? So this is the, and similarly, the product between alphas and beta. So they are basically following this rule. Such anti-commutation rule between the product of two quantity is commonly observed in the matrix. Because if you have a two matrix A and B, then we know that AB is minus BA. They are not equal, but with opposite sign. So this property is already observed among the matrices. So it proves that this alphas and betas, they are not the ordinary number, they must be matrices. So first, understanding that we have obtained that whatever alpha and beta we have multiplied here in order to write this side as a whole square of certain number, then this alphas and beta, they are basically a one type of, they are the matrices, they are not just the ordinary number. Second observation that which we have made, that the square of this alphas and the square of this beta, it is always one, meaning their eigenvalues are always plus or minus. So we have another importance, their eigenvalues are plus or minus 1. They are of value unity. And they are linearly independent but constant matrices. Why they are linearly independent? Because the alpha x alpha y and minus alpha y alpha x, they are contributing same. So basically their summation is 0. So basically they are linearly independent. You can prove also later on when we get the exact form, linearly independent, and value wise, eigenvalue wise, they are having constant value. So we call it as a linearly independent matrices. Right? and they are all following your Clifford algebra. So these alphas and betas are not just ordinary number, but they follow this properties. This property where alpha x alpha y is equals to minus alpha x alpha y alpha x is also known as an anti-commutation property. If I write like this, alpha x alpha y, but with a plus sign in between, so I may write like this. So this is your anti-commutation. This anti-commutator is also observed for the Pauli spin matrices. So, in order to find what these alphas and betas are, who actually obey this relation, which is proposed by the Dirac, they can be constructed in terms of Pauli's spin matrices. And the reason is, Pauli's spin matrices obey all these properties. They follow Clifford algebra, and therefore it is easy to manufacture these alphas and beta in terms of Pauli's spin matrices. So we are now in a position to write these alphas and beta in terms of Pauli's spin matrices. But before we go to that, now we can write the expression for the energy in terms of this alphas and betas. So if we just recollect that C E is equal to plus or minus C, and this C square P square plus M0 C square term, we have written as a whole square of it. So ultimately square root of this, finally what we get is alpha X PX plus alpha Y PY plus alpha Z PZ plus beta M0 C. Correct. So this is the expression for energy of a free particle moving relativistically and derived using derived by the Dirac. Here the same thing we may write, because this is like a x component, so this we can combinedly write as a c into alpha dot p plus beta m0 c. Correct? So this is in a small notation we can write. And we know that correspondingly this can work as the Hamiltonian, because this is the, if we write in the form of operator, then this is your Hamiltonian operator, correct? So corresponding Hamiltonian operator we can write like that. If I take C inside, then the corresponding Hamiltonian operator is alpha dot P plus beta M0 C square, correct? So this is the Hamiltonian operator, Dirac operator that we will be employing to calculate the energy eigenspectra. If you want the Dirac equation, this Dirac relativistic equation can be obtained simply by writing, operating this expression on the state function. So I write now expression E is again written as del by del t, now operating on the state function psi rt. On both sides I will do the same, and p is again written as the minus I h cut nabla. So what I'll have is minus I ch cut alpha dot nabla, and plus this operates on psi rt, plus I have that beta m0 c square into psi that operates on psi, right? This expression is also allowing to write alpha or minus alpha, beta or minus beta. So if you write here alpha as minus alpha or beta as minus beta, there is no change in the expression. So this is in fact is the hint that the energy can be plus or minus. If you write with an alpha plus or minus, the answer will come same. So this is known as the Dirac relativistic equation for a free particle, where what we have introduced is the like Pauli's matrices, the another matrix is alpha and beta, and therefore this alpha and beta, which is derived by the Pauli, so this alphas and betas are known as the Dirac matrices, correct? So by name they are known as a Dirac matrices. And since usually we write this alphas and betas in terms of Pauli's matrices, so in the next part we will find the representation of this alphas and beta combining the Pauli's spin matrices to this Dirac matrices, which we will call as the Pauli Dirac representation. So before we proceed to solve this equation, we will first identify the properties of this alphas and beta. Up till we have said only few things, that their eigenvalues are of unit value, they are linearly independent but constant matrices, and they obey this Clifford algebra. And in terms of Pauli spin matrices, next time we will obtain the exact expression for alphas and beta, their properties, their characteristics, and then we will go on using these alphas and beta to derive further inferences even while including the interaction. So I stop for a while here, and then in the next part we will actually find the characteristics of this Dirac matrices, and once we know about the Dirac matrices, that will be useful for further consideration. So for time being I stop here, and then in the next part we consider the properties of Dirac matrices.
So I think you have realized that how easily employing Clifford algebra and by introducing two new operators alpha and beta, Dirac could obtain its first order differential equation, the relativistic equation. Having obtained this relativistic equation in the first order for space coordinate and the time coordinate, in the next lectures, we will use this equation to obtain first the free particle Dirac equation, and then we apply we will involve the interactions to get more insight to the relativistic case. I hope you have enjoyed this. So I just welcome you for the next lecture. Meanwhile, say bye-bye.